Dear students, you can start joining. You can start joining. Yes, we're not joining the chain. So. Una giornata. Okay, welcome to lecture number 3 on the introduction to the theory of sex. So, in lecture number 3, we are looking at binary operations. Okay, now we can start. So, we are just going to look at this part is all not binary operations. So, under binary operations, remember in the afternoons, we are going to look at, I've already sent the notes, which is lecture number 4, which is on SATs. SATs is a very short but the next, after 30 minutes we can finish that subtopic, or rather lecture. So if we can finish that when we come in school, we can start looking at functions, all the functions when we're done with them, then my colleague would take over from trigonometric functions, complex numbers and matrices. Me will only take you up to from sets and functions, all the types of functions that you're going to learn. So, but my colleague will take up from trigonometric functions up to sets, I mean up to matrices. As such, let's look at binary operations. Now, the question is, you think of binary operations. Binary, let's try to look at the word operations. If I asked you a question, what type of operations do you know from the time you started learning mathematics? What type of operations have you so far learned? So if you can look at, let's try to blind ourselves from the word binary. Now let's look at this, the word operations. We've learned about operations on real numbers, or rather on numbers. We've learned about operations on sets. We've learned about, we're going to learn in fact about operations on set. Okay, to me, if I'm saying you've learned, because you learned this during your secondary school level. You've also, so you've also learned about the intersection, the complement, the union operation. We've also, if I can remember, when you're doing probability at secondary school level, or even the linear programming at secondary school level, you learn something to do with and, or, at least, at most. So all those are some kind of their operations, or depending on the set that you are operating on. Now, or rather the field that you are in, and the type of operations which you're going to use also matters. Now, let's look at what you call a binary operation. So if we have a set A, let's have a set A. I'm going to slow down. Let's have a set A. Let A be a set. This A, let's look at this set not to be empty. Let's look at this set A not to be empty. Okay, now, a binary operation star, this star, other books they use, can use star, they can use psychic, they can use any symbol that you can think of. They can use a bullet. So you don't have to, because you've seen star, then you start seeing also stars in your eyes when you're studying. No, this is just star. It's just some, we want to give it a symbol what this operation is. So a binary operation star on a set A is a well-defined function. There's this word, well-defined function. I know we've not yet done functions, but you know, even if we are using it here, we'll look at it from the trend of you already done functions at your secondary school level. But you're going to look at functions in details in the next topic. Now, it is a well-defined function that you have denoted by star from the product of a set A by itself to A. So what this operation does on the Cartesian, so this is the same, is a well-defined function star from the Cartesian product of A onto itself. So from the Cartesian product A times A, what does this mean? This means the type of elements in A times A is paired. This is the set of ordered pairs. So you pick elements from A times A. Now, then this function acts on those elements. What you produce is another element which is also in A. So this is a well-defined object on the Cartesian product of A onto itself, whose image is in A. So, generally, a binary operation on a set is a function that acts on two elements. So remember, this type of a set contains two elements. It's a set of ordered pairs. So generally, a binary operation is a type of, is a special type of a function. What it does is, it will act on two elements of the set of, so it acts on two elements of a given, from a given set, and produces a third element which is unique in the set. So you get this element,
You substitute them into the function, and then you're going to produce a unique element which still remains in the state where you caught those two other elements. That's how this, that's the uniqueness of this binary operation. Now, binary operations are usually denoted by special symbols. Binary operations, they are denoted by special symbols such as plus, minus, the division symbol, slash means division, the multiplication symbol, star symbol, the union symbol, the intersection symbol, the or symbol, the and symbol. So all these operations are binary operations depending on where you are using them. Now, if, for example, if we have two elements, A and B, which are coming from set A, we usually write A star B. If these elements were sets, if these elements, for example, if we had set B and set C, which are subsets of set A, then what you are going to write here is A, B union C, B intersection C, B minus A, C. So you have all those types of operations. Now, instead of star A comma B, we don't write like that. We write A star B. Remember, A and B, you obtain them from the set A. I hope I'm not too fast. So, now, this is about what a binary operation is. Let's go to the next stage. Now, we have what we call the closure property. The closure property of a binary operation in a given set. Closure. I think you understand. No, closure. Closure. If you are in a closed room or closed being near to someone, you are related to someone, we are closure to each other. So now, let's look at when a binary operation satisfies the closure property. Let's look at this definition number two. Definition number two is talking about the closure property. So an operation star, I've not said it's a binary operation, I've just said an operation. Okay, remember, I defined a binary operation to be a well-defined function. There is a word well-defined. Now, let's look at this operation. Remember, they can be plus, they can be minus, they can be whichever operation, but is this operation well-defined on this set? Is this operation well-defined on that set? So you have all those kind of questions that should be coming, that you should be asking yourself. Now, when is an operation, and what name is given to an operation that satisfied that satisfies the closure property? So an operation star on a non-empty set A is said to satisfy the closure property. This operation that you've been given, whether it's intersection, it's union, it's the complement operation, it's the plus operation, the minus operation, the division operation. Now, how you use them? Remember, if I use the plus, the minus, the multiplication, the division operation, that means I'm using them on what type of sets? On the sets of real numbers. The set of integers, the set of complex numbers, the set of... Now, what if I'm using the union intersection and still I can use this on the set of real numbers, depending on how those sets have been represented. So now, this operation star, it satisfies the closure property. It only satisfies the closure property if whenever you take two elements, A and B, from a given set A, and then this operation acts on these two elements, the final result, your final answer should belong to the set A. So, I, for example, if I pick elements like 2 and 10 from the set of integers, and I subtract those two elements, 2 minus 10 is negative 8. Now, if you look at negative 8, is negative 8 in the set of integers or not in the set of integers? I've used the operation minus. So if you look at negative 8, it belongs to the set of integers. So you're going to say the minus operation satisfies the closure property. Because after picking two elements from a given set, what you produce is a unique element which belongs to that given set. Then you say this operation satisfies the closure property. Now, any operation, as long as that operation satisfies the closure property, any operation that has been given that satisfies the closure property is known as a binary operation. Now, if you have this operation and you've been given this set, and then you pick two elements in this set, and then the operation acts on those two elements, and you realize that the final answer that you get belongs to the same set where you connected those two elements, then that operation is called a binary operation. Now, in this case, if that binary operation satisfies the closure property, then the set where you collected those two elements so that the given operation acts on them, we say the set is closed under the operation star. The set is closed under the operation star if star satisfies the closure property on that set. Now, a set has closure under an operation if this is just some general statement. So we say a set has closure under an operation if the result of performing the operation with two elements of the set is also an element of the set. I'm just clarifying whatever statement I've written above here in this the second sentence above. Okay, now the binary operations, some of them I've listed here, which represent by special symbols, the plus, minus, division, multiplication, star, union, intersection, or and, they satisfy certain properties. They satisfying the closure property and also satisfying certain laws. What laws are these? The laws are the ones we have put in theorem number 3. We call them the algebraic laws of binary operations. The plus symbol, the minus symbol, the union symbol, the intersection symbol, and so forth and so on, satisfy some, depending on the set on which they are defined, they satisfy the following algebraic laws. What are these algebraic laws? We have the associativity law, the commutativity law, the distributive law, the identity law, the inverse law. We are going to look at them one by one until we look at the examples. Let's call it small o, but it's an operation. We call it psyche. Psyche. Let star and psyche be two, not psyche, the one for being mad, no, psyche. It's some symbol which is used in math. Be two binary operations on non-empty set A. Then we have the following. One, associativity law. Okay, note, where are you lost, please? I've just started the class and I've taken almost
10 to 15 minutes explaining about the binary operations. So, associativity law. It's there in your notes. I think you have the notes on your computers, you downloaded them online. Anything to do with notes, tutorial sheets, you go online. You have the... Okay, now, associativity law. Stuff is said to be associative if, in short, stuff satisfies associativity law if A, open bracket, A star B, close star C, is the same as A star, open bracket, B star C, close bracket. For all A, B, C in A. So you pick three elements in A. These elements should satisfy this property. Now, let's look at on the set of real numbers. On the set of real numbers, addition, one, multiplication satisfies the associativity law. You can check. Pick two numbers from the set of real numbers and add them. You can swap those two numbers. You realize that associativity law holds. That is, they are associative. That is, addition and multiplication are associative binary operations. Under commutativity law, under the law of commutative, the commutativity law states that if you have two elements A, B in A, then A star B must be equal to B star A for all the elements A, B in set A. Now, let's look at addition and multiplication. Addition and multiplication are commutative binary operations on the set of integers. But subtraction is not a commutative binary operation. Reason being, you can pick two numbers. Let's pick 2 and 3. 2 minus 3 is equal to negative 1. 3 minus 2 is equal to 1. The final answers are different. So the operation minus is not a commutative under the set of integers. You can pick any integers that you can think of. Let's look at union and intersection of sets. The union and intersection of sets are commutative binary operations on the power set of a set A. Reason being, if you have two sets A and B, A intersection B is the same as B intersection A. Similarly, A union B, oh, let me just say C, sorry. Let's pick C, B and C. If you have two subsets of A, B and C, then B union C is the same as C union B. Also, B intersection C is the same as C intersection B. Those operations satisfy the commutativity law, the distributive law. I remember we talked about the left distributive law and the right distributive law. So under the distributive law, remember I gave two operations, star and sign. So we say that star is distributive over the other operation, which is sign, if A star, open bracket, B sign C, closed, is equal to A star B sign A star C for all three elements that you picked in set A. This is called the left distributive distribution. Left or left distributive law, because you have distributed A with respect to star to B and C with respect to site. Next, open bracket, B side C close star A. This is equal to B star A side C.
sister A. For all any three elements that are going to pick from the set of from the set A, this we call it the right distribution. Next, now this example is telling you, let R be the set of all real numbers. Then, multiplication distributes addition on R. How does multiplication distributing over is distributive over addition on the set of real numbers? This is the situation. Since if we pick three elements A, B, C in R, then A times, the dot means times, open bracket B plus C closed, this is equal to A times B plus A times C. So what operation? In this scenario, our star is the multiplication operation, our side is the addition operation. This is about the distributive law of two with respect to two operations, binary operations. The identity element, we call it the identity element or the identity law. Because of the existence of that element, so we can sometimes call it, we can give this law as being the identity law. Now, an element, small letter E, in the set A, if it exists, if this element, if you are able to find this element, E, in set A, such that whatever element that you pick in set A, and then with respect to the element E, remember, if this element E exists, then if the binary operation acts on an element A and an element E, which you have found in set A, and the final answer that you produce is A, then the element E, we call it an identity element. So there's this element that you're able to find in the set A, such that for every element which is in set A, when the binary operation acts on it with respect to every element in set A, what you produce is that element in set A, then the element E that you are able to find in A, we call it an identity element with respect to star. Now, let's look at addition on R. Can you think of a number in this on the real line? Let me just on the real line. Maybe if you can understand it from that point of view. On the real line, pick any number that you can add with any other number on the real line, such that when you add that same number that you found with any other number on the set of in the set of real numbers, what you get is the same number in the set of real numbers. So let's look at zero. Zero, you can add it with any number, and what you get is that number, not zero. So in short, zero is the identity element in R with respect to addition. This is because any element that you pick A from the set of real numbers, you add it to zero. This is the same as zero plus any that element that you picked in A, which will give you A. Let's look at multiplication. What number can you multiply with any other number to get is that any other number that you pick? So there is this element in set, in the set of real numbers, such that you multiply it with any element A in the set of real numbers, what you get is A itself. Why? When you multiply one by any given number, what you get is that any given number, which is the one down here. For addition on N, the identity element does not exist. In the set of natural numbers,
There is no identity element under addition. There is only an identity element under multiplication. Remember, the set of natural numbers starts from 1, 2, 3, going up. There is no 0. So there is no addition. There is no identity element under addition in the set of natural numbers, but there is an identity element under multiplication. Let's look at if we are dealing with sets. There we are dealing with numbers. Let's look at when you are dealing with sets. If we have this power set, X, let's look at the empty set. Remember, when you intersect an empty set with any given set, what you get is an empty set. So, let's look at the union. Any set X union the empty set, you get X itself. This means the empty set is an identity element over the union operation when we're dealing with sets, but not intersection, no. Also, A is the identity element for intersection on this power set of A. Remember, the power set of A contains A itself. You see, if you intersect the set, any set X, which is contained in the power set of A, with respect to A, what you're going to get is the set X itself. What does this mean? This means set A is an identity element under the intersection operation. Okay, let's look at the inverse of an element. Inverse law. We've talked about the associativity law, the closure law, associativity law, commutativity law, the identity law. Let's now go to the... Moreover, we are stopping at 11:30 because of the delayed time that we had due to internet. So you can bear me, we are stopping at 11:30. When we come in the afternoon, then we'll look at some examples, and then I'll build some examples on the board, solve some examples from the tutorial sheets, and then we'll look at some SADs, and then we'll call it a day. Okay, the inverse of an element. If we have E from the set A, so we are saying let E in set A be the identity element and A be any other element in set A. Then we say that the element A is invertible. The element A is invertible if you are able to find another element B in set A such that when the operation star acts on A and B, what you get is the identity element. So, this class is ending at 11:30 and we are starting at 13:30, so already 1 hour there. Okay, so if you are able to find an element B such that when this operation acts on the set A and the element B that you are able to find in set A, and then the resulting solution, the final answer is the identity element, then we say A is invertible. This element B that you have found in set A, we call it the inverse of A, and we write A to the power negative 1, which is equal to B, the inverse of A. When we are dealing with real numbers, we say the reciprocal of A. For example, if you have 2, what number can you multiply with 2 to give you the identity element 1? It's 1 over 2. You are able to find 1 over 2 in a set of real numbers such that when you multiply it by 2, you get
1. Also, you can think of negative 20. Negative 20, then the inverse of negative 20 is negative 1 over 20. Because when you multiply negative 20 by negative 1 over 20, what you get is 1, which is, I'm now talking about when you are in the set of real numbers. Now, let's look at addition on n. Addition on the set of natural numbers has no identity element. Now, a given set will contain an inverse element if and only if it has got an identity element under that given operation. So it will contain an identity element, an inverse element, under a certain given operation if it has an identity element under that operation. If there is no identity element under that given operation, then no inverse element that will be contained in that set. If you look at addition on n, addition on the set of natural numbers has no identity element. Because it has no identity element, then there is no invertible element. This is under addition, not multiplication. Under multiplication, the set of natural numbers has 1 as the identity element and no element other than 1 is invertible. No element other than 1 is invertible. What is really this statement saying? Remember, we have multiplication here. Can you think of a number, a natural number, that has an inverse which is not a rational number, okay? Which is not written in the form A over B. If you think of 2, does 2 has an inverse element in the set of natural numbers? Is 2 invertible in the set of natural numbers? No. Under multiplication, no. Because, reason being, multiplied by 1 over 2, that's when you can have a 1. But 1 over 2 is not a natural number. 1 over 2 is not a natural number. As such, the only element in the set of integers which has got an inverse element is 1. Remember, 1 over 1 is the same 1. And 1 times 1 is 1. Done. Example number 4 under binary operations. What this example is trying to tell us is that define star on the set of rational numbers by x star y is equal to xy divided by 5. The operations that we are able to see here is the multiplication operation and the division operation in 1. There is the multiplication operation which is giving us x times y in the numerator and divided by 5. So we have this operation, we have star, for example star which is multiplication and cyclic which is division, or they can be swapped. Okay, now the question now says test for above laws. What they are telling us here is, does star which is being defined as xy over 5, where x and y are from the set of rational numbers, does it satisfy the closure property?
Does it satisfy the associativity law? Does it satisfy the commutativity law? Does it satisfy the identity law? Does it satisfy the inverse law? That's what this question is telling you. This is how questions will come in the test, for example. So, now, what should you do here? The first property is the closure law. Now, let me ask you, if you pick two rational numbers, remember rational numbers can be fractions, can be whole numbers, can be natural numbers, all those can be negative, can be positive. If you pick any two rational numbers, let me just say, let's start with two rational numbers, and you multiply them, you multiply, pick of 2 and 3, you multiply 2 times 3, then divided by 5. The final answer that you are getting, is it a rational number or not a rational number? I've given an example, e.g., pick 2 and 3. 2 times 3 is equal to 6. 6 divided by 5, what you're going to get is 1 point, which is 1 point something something. So the answer that you have found, it's a terminating decimal number. So the answer, final answer that you have found, is a rational number. So this means, so this is the statement which is saying, since the set of rational numbers is closed with respect to multiplication, the set of rational numbers is closed with respect to multiplication. That means whenever you pick two rational numbers and then you multiply them, what you're going to find, the final answer you're going to find is a rational number. Since the set of rational numbers is closed under multiplication, then x times y divided by 5, which is equal to x star y, belongs to the set of rational numbers. Hence, now, what you found is, you picked two rational numbers, you multiply them, and then the final answer divided by 5, after dividing by 5, your final result, you discover that it's a rational number. It belongs to the set of rational numbers. As such, the operation, the closure property holds in Q with respect to star, with respect to the operation star that has been defined as xy over 5. Associativity law. For all, if we pick three rational numbers, x, y, and z, then what are we going to have? What we are going to have is x star, then open bracket, y star z, close bracket, is equal to, now, remember, you start with what is in the brackets. This is the same as x star. Now, after the star, open bracket, close bracket, what should be inside these brackets? According to the definition, x star y means x times y divided by 5. Now, if where there's y, I put z, where there's x, I put y, what will happen? Which is the one? Y star z. Y star z, this is the same as y times z divided by 5, according to this definition. So this is y times z divided by 5. Now, what have you done now? What you have done is you have made yz over 5 as being another element. This is also one element. So what you're going to do now, you're also going to apply the same operation again. X star, open bracket, yz over 5. The final answer that you're going to get is, this will be x times yz over 5, everything divided by 5. When you simplify that expression I've mentioned, it will reduce to this, which will give us 1 over 5 times x times y times z over 5. But this expression, using the associativity law of real numbers, of rational numbers, this is the same as x times y over 5, x times y times z over 5 times 1 over 5. Now, this x times y over 5 can be put inside the bracket. So we have x times y over 5, then z, it will be star z. Now, x times y over 5 is the same as x times y, which is on top here. So it says open bracket x star y, close bracket star z. Now, what are we saying about this operation? We are saying this operation is associative. The operation star, which has been defined on the set of rational numbers by x star y, which is equal to x y over 5, is associative. The other reason is this holds because multiplication is associative. Hence, associativity law holds in Q with respect to star. Commutativity law. Under commutativity law, let's look at for all x, y, which you can pick from the set of natural numbers. Remember, you are picking two numbers which are rational, and then you say, for example, 2 star 5, this is what we are talking about. So x star y is equal to x times y divided by 5. But remember, x is a rational number, y is a rational number. Since we can swap these two, we can interchange the position of x and y. So we are going to start with y times x, because multiplication is commutative under the set of real numbers. As such, y star x. Now, let's look at y star x. According to the definition, y is at the beginning, x is in the second position. So even under star, y will be at the beginning, then star x. This means y star x. So what you have shown is x star y is equal to y star x. What conclusion do we give here? The conclusion is that commutativity law holds in the set of rational numbers with respect to star. With respect to star means with respect to the way star has been defined in the set of rational numbers. Let's look at the identity law. Under the identity law, now what do we want to find out? We want to find out if the identity law holds. How can we find out if the identity law holds? We need to make sure that we are able to find the identity element. If we are able to find the identity element, what type of an identity element specifically under the operation that you've been given? Different operations will give you different results. It's not that because Mr. Matindi said that operation, it satisfies all these laws, so any operation that he gives us in the test or exam, it will satisfy those laws. No, it depends to the type of operation that has been given and the kind of set onto which the operation has been defined. So now, let's look at this, the identity law. So let E be an element, be the identity in Q. Now, this is now, we are proving kind of with a contradictive, in a contradictive manner. What we are saying here is, if we say let E be, so we are saying that this element is an identity element in the set. But the question is, can we manage to find E? How will this E look like? How will this E going to look like? Okay, now then, remember, then for any A which is in the set of rational numbers, the element A is equal to, remember the definition of an identity law. It says that if this E exists, then E star A or A star E
it should, the final answer should be A. Whenever the operation acts on the identity element, and with respect to any element A that you have picked, the final answer should be the element A. Now, in this question, do we have the identity element? If you are able to find that identity element, then the identity law holds under in the set of rational numbers over with respect to the operation star. Now, let's look at this. A, according to the definition, A must be equal to E star A. According to the definition of the identity law in the theorem above. Now, but then E star A. But according to this example, what is E star A? According to this example, E star A is equal to E times A divided by 5. Now, what do we have here? So what we are saying is A is equal to E times A over 5. What we are saying is, we can also rewrite, in short, we can rewrite this A, which is equal to E star A, which is equal to AE times A over 5, as being A is equal to E times A over 5. Now, E times A over 5, you see, what we need to find here is E. What we need to find, are we able to find an element E in this equation? So now, this is what I said, solving for E in the equation A, which is equal to E times A over 5, if we solve for E, we are going to obtain that E is equal to 5. You see, so we are able to find an element which is an identity element. So whenever you multiply this 5 with any element E, what you're going to get is the element E. So now, okay, so this is the scenario. So our E in this case is 5. You can think of any number that you can think of. Let's think of 7. 7 star 5, which is our identity element. This is the same as 7 times 5 divided by 5. 7 times 5 divided by 5. Now 7 times 5 divided by everything divided by 5, it will give us 7. So everything is just like that. Okay. Hence, the identity law holds in Q with respect to star. The last but not the least, the inverse law. The question is, we were able to find the identity element in Q, this implies we should be able to find an inverse. As long as you have an identity in a given set, this means you should be able to find the inverse of each and every element in that set. Okay. Let's go to this one. Okay, now, suppose A and B are elements in the set of rational numbers such that A times B, A star B, is equal to E. What are we trying to find here? We have A and B, which you have picked from the set of rational numbers, and then when the operation star acts on these two elements, what you get is E. That's our assumption. But then what is this E? Remember, in part 4, we have found E to be 5. In part 4, we have found E to be 5. This means, the question is, if we have two sets A and B that such that when the operation star acts on them, they give us E. This E is, which is equal to 5. But then, what is A star B? How have we defined A star B? A star B, according to the definition of star under the set of rational numbers, this is equal to A times B divided by 5. So what we're saying is A star B, which is A times B divided by 5, this is equal to 5, which is E. Okay. So if A times B over 5 is equal to 5, now here what you are saying is our inverse in this scenario, according from our definition, is B. So we are supposed to solve for B. We need to solve for B in the equation A times B over 5 is equal to 5. Or at secondary school level, we used to say make B the subject of the formula. So making B the subject of this formula, or solving for B, what you are going to get is B is equal to 25 over A. Now, look at this. 25 over A. You can think of any number. You can think of any number as A. You can have A as 7, A as 8, A as negative 9, A as negative 20 over 20 minus 1. Negative 20, you can think of A as negative 100.475, any value. So whatever value that you're going to pick from the set of rational numbers, if you say 25 divided by that value that you've picked, the final answer will still be a rational number, whether you like it or not. The final answer will still be a rational number. So in short, this 25 over A is in the set of rational numbers. Because 25 is a rational number, A, you pick it from the set of rational numbers. So the quotient of two rational numbers is a rational number. So then we conclude that 25 over A is the inverse of A. Remember, 25 over A is the inverse of A. Remember, if you say 25 over A star A, I can assure you what you're going to get is a 5. Hence, the inverse law holds in Q with respect to star. Example number 5. This example 2 is done. The example that you're looking at, example 4, is done. So what we have done is we have tested all the operations under star.
We are on example number 5. Where is the 5 coming from? The 5 is, we solved it. We had found it by solving. But the other 5 was already in the, don't differentiate between the E, which is equal to 5, as our identity element 5, and the 5, which is the divisor of that expression of the operation star, which was defined on the set of rational numbers, so they are not the same, though in value form they are the same. Sure. Okay, let's look at example number 5. Define star on Z by, here now we are defining star on the set of integers. Remember the set of integers, 0 plus or minus 1, plus or minus 2, plus or minus 3, plus or minus 4, plus or minus 5, up to, and so forth and so on. It continues going, it's an infinite set. Now, let's define star by x star y being equal to x plus y minus 1. X star y is equal to x plus y minus 1. This is how we would find star on the set of integers. X is from z, y is from z, including 1. So in this case, we have two operations here. We have the plus and the minus embedded within the star. Now, the question is here, do closure, associative, commutative, identity, and inverse laws hold in Z with respect to star? Do these laws they have mentioned here, do they hold in the set of integers, specifically with respect to the way star has been defined on Z? Okay, let's look at this. The solution, closure holds. Why do closure hold? Why is it that the closure property holds? It's because, can you think of two numbers? Can you think of any two numbers, please? You know, when I say think of two numbers, you are supposed to have this pen of yours closer to you and the paper. You scratch any two numbers that you can think of, any two integers that you can think of, and then you add them. Let's think of 2 and 7. Okay, someone has proposed 3 and 6. What is 3 plus 6? 3 plus 6 is 9. Now, the answer 9 minus 1. 9 minus 1 is 8. Now, is 8 an integer? Is 8 an integer? Yes, 8 is an integer. Therefore, the 8 that you have found belongs to the set of integers. Now, since this 8 you have found belongs to the set of integers, what are you saying about Z? That means Z is closed with respect to the addition and subtraction operation. Since Z is closed, since Z, whenever you add two numbers, two integers, you get an integer. Whenever you subtract two integers, you get an integer. So, because Z is closed under the operation addition and subtraction, this means the operation that they have defined star, which is x plus y minus 1, which is the same as x star y, any value x and y that you get, they will belong to the set of integers. Therefore, the closure property holds in Z with respect to the way star has been defined. Next, associativity law. Does associativity law hold? Does the associativity law hold? Let's check. There are two ways how you can handle this question, right? Especially the associativity law, even the commutativity law. You do the forward, you do from left, you first deal with the left hand side, you evaluate and find the final answer. Then you also do start from the right hand side, evaluate and find the final answer. So if you discover that the two final answers are the same, the two final results are the same, then you say associativity law holds. But if they are not the same, then you say associativity law does not hold. Now let's do this one. I started from the left hand side and up, and then I started going up to the right hand side. So this is also another way of handling the question. Okay, now let's look at this. X star y star z. Let's start with, this is the same as, now x star y star z is the same as x plus y star z minus 1 according to the way star has been defined. So it will be x plus y. In the position of y, we are going to have y star z minus 1. In the brackets,
Look, this is the same as x, which is this one, plus, now, in the brackets, second brackets, sorry, I've used close here. X, I mean, y star z, if we compare this expression to the way it has been defined, the star has been defined, in these brackets, we are going to have y plus z minus 1. Y plus z minus 1. Minus 1, it's this one. This minus 1 is this one. Then we can rewrite the entire of this sentence as x plus y plus z minus 1 minus 1. Please, don't say 1 minus 1 is equal to negative 2. You will get stuck. Don't combine those. Next, but remember, addition is commutative under the set of real numbers. This will imply I can bring out the z, combine it with the negative, with the minus 1. So I can have x plus y minus 1, open, close, plus z minus 1. Now, x plus y minus 1, it's here, x plus y minus 1 is equal to x star y. As such, what I'll have is x plus y minus 1, I can write it as x star y plus z minus 1. So this means, open bracket, x star y close bracket plus z minus 1. The whole of this statement is the same as open bracket, x star y close bracket star z. That means the associativity law holds. You are done with the associativity law. Holds. This means the associativity law holds in Z with respect to star. Commutativity law is very, very simple. Let's go to commutativity law. What we want to show is that does x star y is x star y equal to y star x? This is what we want to show. We start from x star y. X star y, x, okay, we are going to finish this lecture once I'm done with this example. So x star y is equal to x plus y minus 1 according to the definition of star. Then, but x plus y, we can switch them because addition is commutative, so we can switch these two. This is the same as y plus x minus 1. Now, y is the one starting, plus, then, before the plus operation, it's y first, then plus x, then minus 1. So this is the same as y star x. And we conclude that the commutativity law holds in the set of integers with respect to star. Okay. The identity law. The question is, are we able to find an identity element E such that the operation star will hold? Are we able to find an identity element E such that when we act on that, when the operation star acts on the element, on the identity element E and any other element A from the set of rational numbers, what we get is the element A itself? If yes, then what is that element? What is that given element? This is what we are looking at. Let E be an identity element in the set of integers. Then, for every A that we can pick from the set of integers, according to the definition, according to the properties of an identity element, then the A that we have picked is equal to A star E. Or E star A, one and the same thing. But then, according to the definition of
star on the set of integers, A star E is the same as A plus E minus 1. Now, what does this sentence mean? This means A is equal to A plus E minus 1. The thing that you need to solve here is for E. So that is A is equal to A plus E minus 1. So solving for E, or making E the subject of the formula here, what you're going to get is E is equal to A minus 1 plus 1, which will give us E is equal to 1. So our identity element in this case is 1. Because if we say A star E is equal to A plus 1 minus 1, which will give us A. As such, the identity element under this question is 1. I'm in class, call me after 10 minutes. Okay, so now our identity element is 1. Therefore, the identity law holds in Z with respect to the way star has been defined. Inverse. The inverse law. We need to find an inverse because the identity element exists. That means we should be able to find the inverse under that operation. So, inverse law. Suppose A and B are from the set of integers, are such that this A and B are such that A star B, whenever the operation star acts on A and B, what we get is the identity element. Now, in this question, what have we found in part 2? This was supposed to be part 3. Under the identity law, we have found that our identity element is 1. So what we say is, if A and B are elements from the set of integers, and then are such that whenever the operation star acts on A and B, what we get is 1. Then what is our identity element? So now, look, what is A star B according to the definition? A star B means A plus B minus 1. Also, what we're saying is A plus B minus 1 is equal to 1. The question is, what do we want to find in this equation? We want to solve for B. We want to make B. We want to find B. How can we find B? By solving for B. So in this question, solving for B, making B the subject of the formula, what you're going to get is B is equal to 2 minus A. Solve for B, make B the subject of the formula, what you're going to get is B is equal to 2 minus A. So 2 minus A is the inverse of A in 2. 2 minus A is the inverse of A in Z. I can assure you, if you say A star 2 minus A, what you're going to get, the final answer will be A star 2 minus A is equal to A plus 2 minus A minus 1. And A plus 2 minus A minus 1, it will give us the final answer is going to be 1, which is the identity element. That means 2 minus A is the inverse of A in Z under the operation star, under the way, with respect to the way operation has been defined on Z. Next is example number 6. I think example number 6, you can do it at your spare time. You can look at the way I've done the evaluations, and then you can just finish it up. Okay, so basically, this is the end of lecture number 3. So when we meet in the afternoons, we are going at, I've hammered your time with 6 minutes. So we are going to meet at 13:40, or rather 14 hours exactly. Let's just say 14 hours exactly, but because of some of you, when I say 13 hours, 14 hours, you start coming in around 14:30. And then you start asking questions. So I didn't understand there, when you, of which you know that you delayed by 10 minutes. In college, when you delay by 10 minutes, you've missed a lot. So we are in college now. We should follow time. Every time, time should be your priority. So make sure that you follow time. So we are going to start at 13:40, the afternoon class, of which we are going to look at some questions in the tutorial sheets. Please make sure that you text to the group. Don't text to me directly, because you are there, a lot of you. Everyone will text me, and then which one am I going to read? So you text in your group which questions you want me to answer, questions from question 1 up to question number 5. From question 1, let me just say up to question number 6. There, that's what you're going to. And if you don't say all the questions, this is not how we should answer questions. You should pick questions where you really have difficulties, where you have, you doubt, where you solve but you are doubting. I'm going to use the board in the afternoon. I'll be able to be in the board where everyone is able to see. All right, enjoy your lunch, though it's not yet lunchtime, as we wait for the next class, which is lecture number 4. Lecture number 4 under this course, MSK 111, which is our under science, and also where we look at some questions from the tutorial sheets. Thank you for your time and for listening. Have a nice afternoon.